Hey everyone, here's a summary, just to try to say it. Mental and environmental health are two of the most urgent challenges of our time. And the way forward in these global challenges is to find out what is good for others and to orient this search in ways that motivates each position measuring and reflecting it. Science works towards this elucidation by focusing on specific realms. One demand arising across these realms, from the study of forests to animals to microbes to AI, is the call for a coherent definition of cognition. Recent developments in cognitive, computational, and biological sciences allow us to elaborate and elucidate this definition through the framework of navigability. In this framework, navigability is an assessment of pre-reflective or non-reflective cognition, with reflection, thinking, remembering, etc., scaling out of that same dynamic process. In humans, this highlights the nervous system's positioning system, while also emphasizing the body as an interactive space. In all realms, it shows the importance of spatiotemporal sensory regularities in how systems develop the habits that come to shape both non-reflective and reflective cognition. We could even think of non-reflective cognition as being, making way. The ongoing encounter as development slightly adjusts these scripts such that all is framed by what has come before. Human awareness of this navigation is a further scale of orientation and a means of agency for reorienting past scripts. Understanding cognition as navigability widens our understanding of landscape. Because the architecture of place, physical, social, virtual, social space, places, etc., are the sensory regularities scaffolding our modes of navigation at both pre-reflective and reflective scales, any continuously encountered set of sensory regularities, for example, an office building, a social media platform, a book, a conversation, a forest, even a relationship, even your own thoughts, is also an architecture of this same process. Of its sensory regularities being encountered as a landscape. This is consistent with traditions of phenomenology and deepens and expands important ideas in and around that scholarship, which I will be talking about in further posts. A paradigm linking cognition and navigation widens evidence gathering across traditional subjective-objective dichotomies, allowing us to develop an application for first-person ethnographic observation of specific affordances in a range of landscapes, from urban to virtual to even your own interaction with your own body as a landscape, your own thoughts as a landscape. It also helps us to develop heuristics towards better mental and environmental health. Doing so provides a common working definition of cognition grounded in the phenomenological tradition. As such, it also offers the potential for an ethnographic application that can be implemented across scientific disciplines and scales of interaction, for example, individual or social or societal, towards finding out what is good for others, including other forms of life, while also motivating individual orientation within healthier landscapes. So a little bit more on this common definition of cognition that I mentioned. Above, I stated that navigability is an assessment of pre-reflective or non-reflective cognition, and reflection, thinking, remembering, etc., scales out of that same dynamic process. Within this framework, it becomes possible to assess cognitions as continuums, not one continuum, but multidimensional continuums that can be overlapping, intermixed, integrated, entangled. And it also allows us still to see these cognitions manifesting differently according to whatever the embodiment is that we're assessing. Like, is it my body? Is it your body? Is it the body of my dog? Is it an insect? Is it a tree? And also the landscape that we're assessing. Are we looking at the geographical landscape, at a landscape of a certain conceptual landscape, virtual landscape, social landscape, etc.? All of these can be statistically parameterized, and it allows for a sort of crisp parameterization for what we mean by cognition within these landscapes according to these bodies. So what is that parameterization? Well, it is as follows loosely. An embodied act is cognitive if its activity can be assessed as a trajectory towards a goal. If this trajectory takes place in some landscape, as I was saying, geographic, linguistic, conceptual, social, that can be parameterized and symbolized or modeled, and if there is an affordance vector from the body to the goal that does not depend upon another body for its relevance. So that's an important part, that there's an affordance vector from the body to the goal as we're doing this assessing, that does not depend upon another body for its relevance. So this allows us a clear way of understanding what is or is not cognitive, for means of our assessment at least. And it also assures that to speak of cognition requires that we observe and name the embodied subject that we're assessing, and also the landscape that we're assessing that subject in, because these are all overlapping and there's so many, and it's important that this framework, that we have to be able to say what those are and understand that we're assessing them in the space of assessing, that the process is still going, but we're going to kind of freeze it and assess it for a moment so as to better understand it. So this allows us to understand that different bodies and different landscapes will lead to different cognitions. And there's not like one thing that is cognition that we're trying to fit all of those to. Instead, we start to understand cognition is multidimensional. There's many kinds of it. There's many ways of it we don't need to fit it to something. We don't even need to necessarily define it. But what we can understand is that there's a common pattern. But what's very important about this idea of the affordance vector being able to connect it to that body without it needing some other body for its relevance is that one problem that we have now is we don't have a crisp definition of cognition. And by crisp, I mean that we can understand what is cognitive and what is not in terms of this assessment system three world. And this allows us to do that because this vector allows us a clear understanding of what is or is not cognitive, because we have to have this, because yeah, it allows us a clear assessment of that, because we know we have to have the body and the landscape and the affordance vector. So for example, something like a hammer, you know, or a fence post or something like this would not be cognitive. Clearly, we can clearly see, because it doesn't have this affordance vector from its body. If you wanted to say a fence post is embodied, okay, let's like go with that, or a hammer. But then you have to see that actually that doesn't work, because there is no affordance vector specific to that body, that hammer, or that fence post that doesn't depend on another body for its relevance. So the affordances of the hammer are not the affordances of the hammer. They are the affordance of the user of the hammer. And yes, some people might say, well, if we zoom in, we're going to see a little molecule or atom, and that isn't that alive. Fine if you want to zoom in, but then you're going to have to reset all these parameters, and you're looking at the body is going to be that molecule, and the landscape is going to be whatever the landscape is. It wouldn't even be the hammer. It might be, you know, I don't know, a piece of wood or something, or metal. And then you have to start looking, does it have affordances within that? And then if you want to call that a kind of cognition, it would be the cognition from that particular atomic point of view. But that's not the same as the hammer. Even though the hammer is comprised of that, the hammer is a different level of assessment. We can't say that the hammer is a body, even if we want to say that the atom is a body. And that doesn't cancel one another out in this paradigm, which is very important. So in the next sections, I'm going to look at this formulation more clearly and try to determine, you know, show you what I really mean by these words, because in a lot of our many disciplines, we use these words differently, words like body, affordance, trajectory, landscape. So I want to go through those, look at the literature, where they're coming from, show you what I mean by them and where I'm getting my inspiration from, and see how these words are connected to and similar and sometimes interchangeable with other words in different disciplines. Like, for example, I use landscape, but that's very connected to the way other people might use space or state space or phase space or place even. So I want to talk about some of that and see how these words are grounded. And I'm particularly grounding them in the tradition of phenomenology and cognitive science, which might seem like they don't go together, but I will show you that they do. But mostly in terms of the philosophy, it's from the phenomenology and relative to phenomenology. But I'll explain that in another post. And also in a further section, I'll see how that dovetails with current cognitive science, especially, and neuroscience and developmental biology. As you know, I'm grounding a lot of this in the story of the hippocampus, because I think this demonstrates a lot of this in a very fascinating and productive and rich way. And we even have some kind of computational inspiration there. So I will go into that a bit too. And I'll also start to try to explain that what I really mean by navigability in that sense. I think when we start to look really specifically at the hippocampus and at modeling that's gone on there, we can start to understand that more and start to see how it's something like memory and something like navigation can be understood as different forms of navigability, depending on this kind of paradigm that I just set forth about setting forth what the body is, what the landscape is, and looking for this affordance vector. Yeah, and then after that, I want to start to look at how this really matters in real life. Why does it matter? What does it change? What could it change? How does it how does it relate to very practical issues like how we design our cities, for example, or the kind of transportation we want and use, or the way we use social media? There's a lot of important consequences there, which I really want to get into. And then in yet another section, I want to look at it's not so new, but mathematical modeling and mathematical kinds of math, something like category theory, for example, and also complex systems work and complex systems. I want to look at some of these and start to an active inference, of course. I want to look at this and the way that it connects to technology and see if there's a way that we might create some kind of technology, or we might already be creating technologies that would let us start to hold a more multidimensional rather than a binary understanding of, or not even understanding, more our everyday assumptions tend to still be binary and linear, and we tend to still use math in that way and language in that way, and that's all fine. But with this whole thing that I've just described, I think it requires that we shift into a more multidimensional, complex network, fractalized understanding of what's going on when we're talking about behavior and cognition. And I think that we've got some tools and maths that are already beginning to show us ways to visualize that. So I also want to talk about that too. And also just, of course, all of this is for trying to hear other people's ideas about it, because you probably all know a lot about different parts of this that I don't know yet. And so I want to be able to open it up and see where the gaps are, see what I don't see, and also hopefully do the same, you know, and vice versa. So that's what all this is about. And I will continue to post and try my best. And I invite you to write to me privately. The email's in the notes, or write to me here. Just, you know, try to be not too harsh, but please feel free to criticize and say directly what you think. Okay. Thank you. I really appreciate that you listened to this. Bye.